Fair. Other thing that kind of ties the room together here are the cantrips. There's some brainstorms. There's a ponder. And your favorite card, two copies of Cataxian Probe. This is certainly the kind of deck that you want to know if the coast is clear and you can go for it.
Yeah, because it's a legacy deck.
Yes.
So, yeah.
Information is kind of important, you would say.
Oh, in the brainstorm days, spell pierce, shuffle away cards in my hand, might get killed on turn two, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera format.
Yeah,
it seems significant.
As a glistener elf, that's going to start things off here for our coverage in round number five. We do appreciate you guys joining us here. A little legacy action. We're going to watch a wooded foothills get sacrificed. Same thing we said as a bloodstained mire, one at a time there for Blackmore. So he's going to get on 18. One thing that's really nice for Jason is that his life total really doesn't matter in this matchup. Has Tom won regular style? He has. It does happen on occasion with Noble Hierarch and, you know, some pump spells. It's definitely, there have been stories where it has happened. But by and large, Jason's life total does not really matter here.
At Grand Prix Portland, which is modern,
yep,
I was killed by damage.
Ew.
Yeah.
That's gross.
Riker on a Noble Hierarch.
When you were playing Zoo?
Oh, yeah. I was using my life total as a resource, right?
Yeah.
Go get my Ravnica dual land untapped and take all the damage and... Oh, it caught up.
Yeah. Who cares?
Just Noble Hierarch and Riker and some giant gross, man. Couldn't win.
Jason going to pass the turn back right now with the fetch lands. Sounds like he's a little bit familiar with Tom's deck list. Tom has been known to play Stifle in this deck, and he does have two copies. So don't want to get got.
Well, he might get got here in a different way. If he is sitting on Abrupt Decay, then Vines of the Vast Wood might be big-time trouble.
This is neat. This is a Cataxian Probe, and this is very important because Tom gets to see Diabolic Edict, a card that he may not know about otherwise. And there you see two Tarmogoyfs, a Sylvan Library, a Bolt, a Wasteland, and the Edict.
And what's awesome about this, I believe Tom has a Dryad Arbor in his hand so he can protect himself from the Diabolic Edict after this resolves.
I believe there's also an Inkmoth Nexus hanging out there too. Cataxian Probe proving its worth. Chances are he would not play around Diabolic Edict there. He would play around a spot removal spell like Lightning Bolt or Abrupt Decay. But now he knows about the Edict. He doesn't know how many there are. And again, there's only one in Jason's deck list, but having that information is certainly relevant.
Yeah. It's almost like the information mattered.
It's crazy. Here is the Edict. Tom's going to sacrifice Misty Rainforest. He can't sacrifice that fast enough. I have a feeling we're going to see a Dryad Arbor go to the graveyard.
Possibly a Nexus.
Yeah, he says Dryad Arbor. See you later, alligator. And that means that the Glistener Elf can come across here for two. One, of course, from the regular power, and then one from the Exalted from Noble Hierarch. So thank you very much, Cataxian Pro, for being such a good magic
well,
card.
Well, he had to pay a big cost there.
Did he?
Oh, wait, he drew a card, too, somehow.
Ah, yeah.
That totally slipped my mind.
Well, he is at 17. We can't forget about the two life that he paid. That's a cost.
That is a
cost. He does have to pay two life.
That is technically a cost, yeah.
Blackmore says, I'm going to Lightning Bolt this. Tom says, all right, it's dead. You got the job done. Now there's a Wasteland, so Tom without mana now. But you do see his hand. He does have an Inkmoth Nexus over there. I believe he also has a Blighted Agent as well, but he's going to, going to take a second here. There's the Nexus, and now there is the Agent. You also see the Brainstorm over there in Tom's hand, too, so he's rebuilding just fine.
That was a very aggressive use of Wasteland. I think what I would have preferred that turn would be to cast the Tarmogoyf.
Get a
clock on the table, and then use the Wasteland as protection.
Well, here's a Thought Seize. You're going to see Vines of Vastwood, along with a couple fetches there, and then a Brainstorm.
And this is a hand, you know, what's interesting about this deck is we get hung up on the combo element of it, of, you know, Invigorate plus Berserk. Tom can win as a conventional beatdown deck of sorts. He doesn't have to combo out to win the game.
He can play an honest game. That's actually what I kind of like about the deck, is that he can just play some honest magic.
Well, I mean, honest is...
strong.
Yeah, that's sort of a subjective thing, but...
It's time to brainstorm. He'll draw a brainstorm, a library, and... days. We'll figure out how Tom wants to organize things here.
Yeah, I think he's going to get rid of Fetchland and Crop Rotation because he already has the lands he wants at this point.
So there is your Fetchland. Sacrifice that Verdant Catacombs. Go hunting. I imagine it's going to be a Trop to turn on the days. But Tom will make sure, and there he does go get the Trop. I hope we have our Tom Ross Infect tokens at the ready.
Oh, he posted on Twitter that he actually got the 10th one altered by RK Post earlier today.
I did see that.
Yeah.
RK Post in the house here at the Open Series. So here's an attack. Exalted trigger. Deal some damages. And now it's time to deploy a Sylvan Library with a Daze at the ready, doing a really nice job of masking it.
Yeah, this deck has... Obviously, numerous angles of attack. You're seeing them all in display here.
Bolt's going to take care of the agent. No, Blackmore's going to play a Bloodstained Aura. Don't forget, Tom has a really good idea of what's in Jason's hand right now.
Yeah, a couple Goyfs.
There might be one mystery card hanging out there. You see Jason's going to sacrifice the Bloodstained Aura to go get a land. But that Cataxian Probe did a lot of solid work this game.
Yeah. I mean, that Diabolic Edict play, as you mentioned, it's probably not on Tom's radar. Most decks play zero copies, even if they're playing this sort of Jund style of deck. But it definitely influenced the way that Tom was able to navigate that turn.
Yeah, it lets him sequence everything differently. And also knowing about the Lightning Bolt and deciding, okay, I can let my creature go is a thing as well. Because he has some in reserve. So it's a library. And he sees the Badlands is available. I believe Jason just has two cards left in his hand. Those are the two Tarmogoyfs that Tom doesn't know about.
I believe it's two copies of Tarmogoyfs.
Yeah. So the green light is basically on here. Tom's going to activate a Sylvan Library here. Looks like he's going to pay some life to add some cards. Here's a Brainstorm. Get a little deeper in the old deck here.
I love it. Tom adding, taking all three cards, trying to dig deeper here.
He finds Invigorate, it's game over.
Yeah, Invigorate here is plus four, plus the Exalted Trigger.
And the one from the Nexus, that makes it six.
Days back up.
Yeah, he keeps it pretty quick. He's going to get in. There's the Trigger, there's the Invigorate. He knows the two cards that are there that are Tarmogoyfs. Four plus six is 10. What's the magic number?
Days in the hand even if something weird happened.
Yeah, and Jason says that is going to do it. So Tom Ross does get the job done with Invigorate yet again. He's up a game over punishing Jund.
And I believe that was a turn four kill through Lightning Bolt and Diabolic Edict.
Whatever.
Two bolts. And Thoughtseize.
Yeah. It's easy. Come on, it's easy, Patrick.
Again, this deck looks a little gimmicky on paper, but it is anything but. This is a legitimate deck.
I like that he's found the right number. It feels like everything. Pump spells, creatures with infect, manipulation. That's the thing I really like about the deck. You know, you could be overloaded with any of those effects, your deck isn't as efficient as it's supposed to be.
Yeah, I covered Tom kind of playing this deck for the first time in the Open in Atlanta.
Okay.
And the deck list at that point had a lot more weird ones and two ofs. It's clear over time that's become a lot more streamlined. So that's definitely highlights the amount of labor that Tom has put into this deck.
Let's take a look at the sideboard, shall we? We're going to start with Jason Blackmore's, which you have in front of you.
A Toxic Deluge, a Crozan Grip, three Pyroblasts, a Surgical Extraction, two Duress, an Ancient Grudge, two Engineer Plague, Phyrexian Revoker, an Umazaz Jitte, a Graftaker's Cage, and Nile Spellbomb. There's a lot to like here. I think that the Toxic Deluge is fine. It's not the ideal matchup because of Nexus can still kill you, but Deluge does still do valuable work here. The Crozan Grip, an excellent answer to Inkboth Nexus. Pretty safe almost no matter how Tom's trying to combo out. I think two copies of Duress is good here. Ancient Grudge, again, more answers to Inkbot Nexus. It's the most powerful card in Tom's deck. It's the thing that Jason needs to adapt his deck the most to fight over. I think the two copies of Engineer Plague are good as well. They're permanent answers to all the one-toughness creatures in Tom's deck. And, of course, Umazawa's Jitte. If that gets online and is uncontested for a couple turns,
it's over.
Tom can't catch up.
Two Blue Blasts, a Caracas, a Bajuka Bog, a Piracy Charm, an Ecropede, a Viridian Corruptor, three copies of Nature's Claim, two Force Will, a Flesh Storm, and two copies of Submerge. Now the lands are in the sideboard, of course, because crop rotation exists, but I think the easy cards to bring in here are number one, Piracy Charm, because it does kill Dark Confidant, which I think is important. Number two is Necropede.
Yep,
that's an interesting one as well. Just an additional infect creature that if you do kill it, you kind of get punished a little bit for doing so. Force of Will, I don't think is great in this matchup. I don't think you have any interest in two for one of yourself. Though protection is kind of nice, but one of the protections, you know, one of the spells that you protect yourself against is uncounterable in Abrupt Decay.
Furthermore, Jason has a lot of removal in the deck. I think Force of Will is good in matches where you're concerned about one card specifically, but Jason has Punishing Fire, Abrupt Decay, Lightning Bolt, Diabolic Edict, possibly other removal in his sideboard, so there's too much to fight over. I don't think Force of Will really works.
Do you like those two copies of Submerge here?
They're probably fine. They're not ideal in the matchup. Again, if Jason's going to win, it's going to be through removal and not really tempoing out, but it still feels like a worthy inclusion.
It's funny, like, you know, he's a blue-green deck, Jason is a green deck, so you would think that Submerge would be a home run, but I think in this matchup, it's just, as you said, just fine.
It's just okay, but it does clear Tarmogoyf out of the way. It is a free tempo play, which is nice in the matchup. And I think it does valuable work against Umezawa's Jitte.
Okay.
You know, Jason takes his turn playing it and equipping it, or playing it and equipping over the course of two turns, and Submerge can be a huge swing in those kind of situations. It's also a hard card to identify, because Tom can play it, of course, when he's tapped out.
Yeah, I think, you know, I still think this is a tough matchup for Tom because there's a lot of removal here, but Tom has navigated around removal-heavy decks before, so I think that he'll probably be okay here.
Yeah, no, it's there's a lot to slog through, but Tom's done it before. The only times I've seen Tom really struggle in matchups is against something like Blue-White-Red Stoneforge, which has Bolts and Plows and Lavamancer and Umezawa's Jitte and the ability to find it on time. You need to overload with one mana removal.
Deathrite Shaman's going to start the show here off of Badlands. You see Tom drawing Invigorate for the turn. Looks like he was going to play a forest, but maybe he's changed his mind. Looks like he has multiple copies of Glistener, so he's going to lead off of one of those before passing the turn.
And his hand has Invigorate Berserk, so...
Ever heard of it? The old 1-2 punch? Let's see what this is going to be. That's pretty smart. Abrupt Decay that now. Don't let any nonsense happen, like Vines of the Vastwood.
Yeah, I like that. Just don't get fancy here. Just cast your stuff.
Yeah. And Deathrite Shaman does come in. Some Misty Rainforest.
It's really fun watching Tom in action with this deck.
I agree. Tom is a master of his craft with the decks that he plays. You know,
yeah.
He does it with red aggro on standard. He does it with Infect here. He's going to start by sacrificing that Misty Rainforest. We'll see what land he wants to search up.
Oh, and all the stereotypes of people who play aggressive decks just throwing their cards at people and not really thinking about things. Tom is studious and thoughtful at the table.
Let's see what this is going to be. You see a Noble Hierarch and a Glistener Elf in hand. I think he also has two copies of Glistener Elf there.
And he has brought in the Submerge also.
Had a feeling he might. Again, not a home run in this matchup, merely good.
Well, if Tom wins the game on turn three, then Submerge is pretty sweet.
I suppose it's a home run.
That's then. A whole turn.
Yeah, I suppose it's a home run.
And the game's not that many turns.
Couple copies of Glistener Elf, gonna pass the turn back. Tom is threatening lethal next turn. Now, Blackmor could have a crazy play this turn. You know, playing a land and engineered play. That would be a beating.
That would be excellent.
Don't know if he has it, but the reason you saw Submerge that turn is one, to deny Blackmore's draw step, and two, that Deathrite Shaman could provide mana from the Misty Rainforest that went to the graveyard. And so Tom wants to basically cut his opponent's options and then go for the W next turn.
Only harm can come by allowing Jason to untap.
Yep. And so there's an Abrupt Decay. And yep, that Tom couldn't untap faster.
Sorry about that whammy.
And now he gets to see in case there's something. I don't know what you could have. Yeah, Tom's like, I don't even care about those cards. Draw a card.
Gunshot, I guess.
Yeah. Cast a Noble Hierarch. Cast Invigorate. Cast Berserk. See you later.
Sorry.
Alligator.
Sorry about that.
Whammy.
Is that turn three through two Abrupt Decays? Yes, it is.
Yeah, looks to be 10 to me, Tom Ross. Moving on, he goes to 4-1 with Infect.
Oh, yeah, some of that.
I do like that the last turn he got to probe just to make sure nothing went wrong.
Yeah.
That's one of my favorite parts of that one. Tom Ross going on to 4-1. Congratulations.